has been an estate planning lawyer for 35 years and is a contract attorney for Family Caregiver Alliance. Matt is certified by the California State Bar Board of Legal Specialization as a specialist in estate planning, trust, and probate law. He is a frequent lecturer, teaching seminars on estate planning and elder law to fellow attorneys, professionals, and to the general public. He is a former member of the Board of Directors of California Advocates for Nursing Home Reform, or CANR, and he has served for more than 25 years as a core instructor for their statewide attorney elder law conferences. In 2009, he was awarded the William Taylor Memorial Award by CANR in recognition for his service to long-term care consumers. He has also lectured for the California Continuing Education of the Bar, Senior Focus, the Alzheimer's Association, Kaiser Hospital, and the Northern California Probate Examiners Association. Please welcome to the stage, Matthew O'Donnell.
I really enjoyed Mary's talk, and I thought maybe I probably would have spent a lot less time in probate court in my career had the conversation started earlier. Anyway, my background is I've been an estate planning attorney now for about 35 years. I opened my practice in Menlo Park when I was 26 years old. My dad was the local butcher at Drager's Supermarket, and the way I got my cases to begin with is he wrapped my card in the chicken and sent it home with people, and they marched down to my office. Within 4 years, I had 120 rear-end car accident cases. I had family law cases. I had fence disputes. I even defended a dog from the death penalty who chased a judge down the street in Atherton and got him off. I really became disillusioned with being an attorney. I think I was meant to be a high school history teacher. And in fact, I was even considering doing that. But I answered an ad in the Bar Journal, where the Legal Aid Society in Redwood City was looking for volunteers to screen for their staff attorneys. And I answered the ad, showed up for work on a Wednesday afternoon, and I got really lucky because by the senator by the name of Claude Pepper, the history of it is that he arranged that as a condition for funding, Legal Aid had to give free consultations to seniors. So Wednesday afternoon was senior afternoon, and here I was in front of six seniors over the course of 3 hours, not knowing a thing about what they were asking me about, which was really incapacity planning, estate planning. I just kept running into the senior attorney's office, and I really got excited about the area of law. And I got lucky, and I met a woman by the name of Pat McGinnis, who was starting a charity at that time called California Advocates for, it was called Bay Area Advocates for Nursing Home Reform at that time, and now it's California Advocates. And she recruited me to their first training, and I do all the statewide, for the last 25 years, I've done all the statewide attorney trainings for CANR. I was able to go into my ex-partner's office, get rid of all my litigation cases. I haven't sued anybody in 30 years. And it's a really, really positive practice, like your practices. But the area of long-term care planning, because of CANR's work, has taken a real turn over the last year and a half, because they were successful at getting through the anti-recovery law, which most of you are probably familiar with. It used to be that when a person was on public benefits, the state could come after their assets at death to be reimbursed. Now, as long as a recipient of public benefits can avoid probate, like having a trust or joint tenancy or pay on death deeds or whatever, if there's no probate, there's no recovery. So it's taken a lot of, I've noticed a big change because it's taken a lot of intrigue out of the area of practice. So for example, I would say over the last 20 years, I've probably done 700 or 800 house transfers. So in other words, you can transfer your house without any problem. It's an exempt asset. It doesn't cause any period of ineligibility. I'll talk about that in a second. But as a way of blocking the state from coming after people's assets, you had usually had to transfer their house out of their name. This is a Medi-Cal recipient before they die. So there used to be tons of intrigue because you would get a call. My mother's, and here's an example, years and years ago, my mother is in a nursing home in Half Moon Bay. She's been on Medi-Cal for 4 years. There's probably about a $300,000 or $400,000 potential claim against the house, and she has 3 days to live, all right? So I remember this case, because it's kind of, this is when my kids are in their 20s now. They were like 2 and 3 years old at the time. I dropped everything. I went over to the coast. I brought a quick claim deed over there and had her transfer the house to her daughter. She had cancer. She was competent. And as I was driving back over, back to Menlo Park, over the mountain, she died. Okay, and so this deed now blocked the claim, all right? So the next day, the deed's sitting on my paralegal's desk, and my wife brings my little guys to come and get me on Friday to get me home. And my paralegal's in the restroom, and they go in, and they take the received stamp and obliterate the deed. So there's a solution to everything in estate planning, though. There's a code section that says you can file a declaration saying what the deed said, and it's a good deed. So they escape the claim. But the purpose of my story is not to, you know, it engenders a lot of confidence in my office, I know, but. So obviously, my kids aren't allowed near my paralegal's desks anymore, but. What I'm saying is that there was just tons of intrigue back then. This would be like a weekly thing for me where people would call. They didn't have the conversation early, as Mary said. They didn't do anything, and all of a sudden, now they're trying to do everything at the last minute. But that intrigue is somewhat, not over, but now there are easier things to do in order to avoid claims. So anyway, I deviated a little bit. And what I want to talk about is I want to sensitize you just to the different issues in estate planning and long-term care planning. What I'm going to talk about in the next 20 minutes is probably about an 8-hour seminar. But I'm going to try to squeeze it in, okay? So, and I was asked today to also cover general estate planning, although, you know, I know this conference is really dementia-oriented. But they wanted me to cover just the different death choices people have when they have the conversation. So I think I have, let me see here, okay. So the continuum of care, long-term care, I look at it as the definition as a continuum of care, a number of services that are linked together. The patients or your clients will use a group of services, and they'll move through this, they'll move back and forth. What I find is that they might be in independent living, or they might be at home. They might go into a hospital, then into skilled nursing, back into assisted living. You know, it's a moving target, as we all know, about their care. So you're trying to help them manage that or manage it. But what most of the clients are concerned about, actually, when they come and see me, is they're concerned about how to pay for care. That's the first thing that's on their mind. The first thing, you know, when general estate planning clients come to you, what they're really come to you for is because they think they're going to owe taxes if they don't do anything with their estate plan, okay? Or they're going to have a big probate bill by having the estate pass through court. But when long-term care clients come to see you, what was really on their mind is that the cost of care, which is just incredible. So, how is care funded in long-term care? Well, the first thing is private pay. Okay, so people come in. They might have, say, you get somebody that's at home, all right, and they want to stay at home. The benefits at home are fairly limited, and I'll just talk about that a little bit in just a little bit. But normally, people will either have to use their own private money to finance long-term care through the use of maybe they have savings, or maybe they use their houses around here. They're able to use their houses, either a line of credit, reverse mortgage, maybe even a conventional loan in order to pay for care. Long-term care insurance, in my 35 years of practice, I've probably seen five long-term care policies come through with all the clients I've seen. I've probably seen 4,000 clients. And I don't know if it's because people didn't purchase them, and then the long-term care policies are very difficult to use. Sometimes they can't get access to the benefits. They have elimination periods. So I very rarely see long-term care insurance come through my office, but that's a means of paying for care. Medicare, as you all know, is professionals. Probably in the long-term care world, I think there's a study that said the average days in a nursing home or days of care paid for by Medicare is 26 days. So we all know that, you know, the most you can get is 100 days, and the second after being 100 days, and the second 80 days is subject to a pretty hefty copay. Medicare, when you move into a nursing home, Medicare will pay if you've been in a hospital for 3 days, but again, there's a limit of 100 days. So if people can't afford private pay, they don't have long-term care insurance, or Medicare is run out, then they usually turn to the Medi-Cal program, okay? So the Medi-Cal program, basically, it's a program where you qualify if you're aged, blind, or disabled, and you have less than $2,000 in countable assets. So most people look at me and say, well, that means hardly anybody's on Medi-Cal, is that correct? Well, no, because there are there are significant non-countable assets, otherwise known as exempt assets. What's the big non-countable asset that a person can own? A residence. This is good. Okay, a residence. Okay, they can own retirement accounts, all right? And the stat on retirement accounts is 37% of all the wealth in the United States sits in retirement accounts like IRAs and 401ks. Those are exempt assets, okay? So there's also there's also this thing called the community spouse resource allowance. It's an allowance that the spouse at home can keep, and it's around $123,000. Also, in limited situation, there are these things that I don't like, but they're out there. They're called immediate annuities, okay? So then there's also these allowances can be increased by court order. So I can go into Superior Court, and I might even, I think the largest increase of the CSRA that I ever got was about $900,000. But you can go into court. You used to be able to do it by an administrative hearing. You're not able to do that anymore. But you can get allowances increased. There's also gifting opportunities that you can avail yourself to in the long-term care world. The Medi-Cal world is really divided up mostly into skilled nursing facility Medi-Cal. I'm kind of simplifying this, and at-home or non-skilled nursing facility Medi-Cal. Skilled nursing facility Medi-Cal is pretty straightforward. It's probably the easiest form of Medi-Cal. It's just that you have to be aged, blind, or disabled, the Medi-Cal recipient or the applicant with less than $2,000, and there's all those allowances and exemptions. And then what they do is you're in the nursing home, this has to be a Medi-Cal certified nursing home, and Medi-Cal will pay the complete cost of care minus a share of cost or a copay, which is usually your income. However, when you have a spouse at home, you get a higher income. You can go to court to increase your income allowance. So that's skilled nursing facility Medi-Cal. The more complex Medi-Cal is trying to stay at home, as you probably all know. There are different programs. There's IHSS, in-home support services. There are these waiver programs that are, when we were at the Cantor seminar or the conference in November, we had someone from the state talk to us about waiver programs. I think there's like 30 or 40 of them, and they're just indecipherable. And the problem with the waiver programs is that they have limits. I mean, in other words, they get filled up, and you're on a waiting list. So it's all well and good to talk about them with your clients, but usually they can't get on them. The other thing is if your clients have a higher income, sometimes they don't make sense to be on the waiver program or do all the stuff you have to do to qualify for Medi-Cal, because your income is too high and your share of cost or copay would be too high to be worth the investment. One of the most wrenching things that I have to do, I just had that, you know, last week we were talking about qualifying for one of these at-home programs. I always have to talk to the clients about longevity. You know, like I'll have a spouse there and I'll have to say, well, this is what I had to say last week. How long does your husband have to live? Well, I would say he's got 4 to 5 months to live. Then I said, look, don't go down the road of Medi-Cal at this point. Just make the investment to keep him at home, pay for the private care. It's not worth the agony. So we have to have that conversation, unfortunately. So again, I only have 20 minutes, so I'm covering the Medi-Cal world in 5 minutes here, okay? So, all right. So the other is veterans benefits. If you're a veteran, you should explore. I'm not certified to do veterans work. I have somebody that does that for me, but it can add to your income to keep you, to add to your pension income in order to pay for services at home. Okay. So in estate planning, long-term care planning and estate planning, I always tell people incapacity planning is the most important planning. It's the most frustrating for people that come to me that I said, my husband's in a nursing home, my wife's in a nursing home, she doesn't recognize me, and I haven't done any estate planning. So guess what happens when you haven't done estate planning? Then what happens is the judge and the court are involved in your family life. You want to keep the judge and the court out of your family life, mainly because it's a hassle and it's also expensive, okay? So the two most important documents in anybody's portfolio, and we've talked extensively about the second one, 15 minutes, oh good, I'm doing good, 15 minutes, excellent. Okay, so a durable power of attorney. A durable power of attorney is a document where you appoint an agent to make financial decisions for you if you're incapable of doing that yourself, okay? And I always tell people, don't cheap out on these things. Don't go on the internet and download a durable power of attorney. Why? Because you won't find gifting authority in those documents. Why is gifting authority important? Because in the long-term care world, for eligibility purposes, the person in the nursing home can't have any assets other than exempt assets in their name. So a lot of times I have to gift those exempt assets out, and if I don't have gifting authority, then I'm in court seeking gifting authority, okay? And $10,000 later, I have my gifting authority from the judge, because in San Mateo County, they require independent counsel for each person that you want to get an order against, not against, but for in court. So in other words, so here's another, I'm going to skip trust because I'm going to get into that later. So here's an example. I have a spouse, they have a stock account. Spouses, I have a stock account, and now they want to qualify their spouse for Medi-Cal who's in a nursing home. I have to move all the liquid assets over to the well spouse in order to comprise this thing called the Community Spouse Resource Allowance. I get this all the time. My husband kept the stock account just in his name, okay? And there's $200,000 in there. Now I have to get that over to the well spouse. If I don't have a durable power of attorney with gifting authority, I can't get it over to the well spouse to qualify the husband who's in the nursing home for Medi-Cal, all right? So now I'm in court seeking this thing called a probate code section 3101 spousal petition, asking for a single transaction. Your Honor, can I have permission to transfer that stock over to the wife? That's fine, but we need independent counsel for the husband. It's in the law, it's not the judge's fault, all right? But so then the independent counsel's $3,000 to go see the husband, to write a report for the court, now I'm in the hearing, right? Okay, so that's why if you wanna get a durable power of attorney that has comprehensive gifting authority, you'll see the things you get in the stationery store will say, I give my agent the authority to make gifts within the annual gift tax exclusion. What's that? $15,000. Okay, so you might want to have an unlimited gifting authority if the circumstances are correct, right? If the circumstances are right in the family, spouses should give each other unlimited gifting authority, particularly if they're getting along. Okay, so, all right. So, conservatorships, you want to avoid them like the plague. They're worse than 3101 petitions, which at least you go into court on a 3101 petition. It's a single or double transaction petition. You're out. There's no ongoing jurisdiction. But you might need a conservatorship instead. Then there's ongoing jurisdictions. There's accountings and everything else. So all the stuff down below, the two things down below, can be avoided if you have the one thing up on top, which is a durable power of attorney for property management. Okay. Now, what are the different ways people plan their estate? This is the most popular way that people plan their estates. They do nothing. Okay, so it's called intestate succession, all right? And so if you have trouble sleeping tonight, you can pull out probate code section 6400 and find out where your estate's gonna go if you don't have a will. Because the legislature has a will for you, and you might be surprised what the will says, okay? So so here's an example. I had a guy who came into me about 5-6 years ago, and he was living with a woman for 30 years in her mother's house, which she inherited in San Mateo, and she had Alzheimer's. So he came to see me. He thought there was common law marriage, okay? And I said, well, no, I'm sorry. That's in Texas. It's not here. But that's not the case. So we talked about how to plan for, you know, to pay for her care and everything. And then I didn't see him again. You know, and then he called me about 2 months later and he says, oh, I have bad news for you. She died. And I said, oh, that's too bad. I said, that's really bad. Then the sister lived next door, her sister. Okay, they had two houses. And I said, well, I hope you get along with the sister well, because now she is the intestate heir of your significant other or your companion. So he said, oh, no. I looked in our paperwork, and we were in a restaurant about 10 years earlier, and I guess she wrote on a napkin, I leave my entire estate to Robert, and dated it and signed it, says it was her will. I introduced it in court. It got admitted as her will, and everything was fine. He got the house. It's not a great way to do your estate planning, but I'm just saying, if you haven't done an estate plan, okay, I would suggest you do what I call a holographic will, a will just in your handwriting. Where people get in trouble is they go on the web and they download a typewritten will from Alabama, okay? And it doesn't have what's called an attestation clause. What is an attestation clause? It says two witnesses that sign it saying they saw you sign it and you saw them sign it. Then it's a good will if it's typewritten. But if it doesn't have a witness clause and it's typed, it's a bad will. It's an invalid will. But if it's in your handwriting, it doesn't have to be witnessed. It doesn't have to be notarized. It just has to be proven that's your handwriting and it's a good will. So some of my clients who come in who haven't done their estate plan, they say, well, what happens if we walk across to the parking lot and get hit by a bus? I said, if you're really worried, let's do a holographic will right now. And just so that's done, so you're sure that, you know, because like people, I've already get this once a month. People come in their 50s, they just got married and they have no kids. All right? So they always laugh. They always say, oh, we're the easiest case you're going to have tonight because we have no baggage. Do they have baggage? They have tons of baggage. They're a blended family because half of their estate under the probate code is going to go to their family and the other half's going to go to their spouse. So when they hear that, they want to do a holographic will right away, okay? So anyway, this is, again, part of the conversation. So gifting. Gifting is a good way of doing your estate plan, except I always tell my elderly clients, you're more popular in the family when you have the money, okay? So you get more invitations at the holidays. People treat you differently within the family. So I really caution my elderly clients not to make gifts. What's the other problem with making gifts? You are going to give a rotten basis to whoever you're giving the gift to. What's basis? I always say the only good thing about dying in our country is if you die owning something, whatever you own gets a brand new basis equal to the market value. So you bought your house for $100,000 around here, and now it's worth $1 million. The basis is $100,000. $1 million is what you're going to sell it for. $900,000 is the capital gains tax. Okay, but if you die owning it, the basis steps up from $100,000 to $1 million. Okay, so if you go, so it was a bad one. I had one. I always love my elderly clients. How much did you buy your house for? $19,500. You know, they always say it's like $19,500, and you know, I pay that $500 every year in Prop 13 tax, and I don't know what the government does with all that money. But the so I had one a year back when the capital gains tax is 30%. Okay, when you add Fed and state, it's 30%. Okay. So I had one, about 15, 20 years ago when the capital gains tax was a third, just Fed was a third. So son living with his mother. Mother's in a nursing home. He's lived with her all her life. She was one of those. She bought her house for $20,000 in Los Altos. Now back then it was worth $600,000. Goes down to Staples and picks up a quitclaim deed and has her sign it. And now she dies. Then about 4 months later he sells it. All right. Then he goes to the accountant to do the taxes, and the accountant says, oh, so sorry, your mother died. I assume she owned the property when she died. Oh, no, she gifted it to me before he died. He paid $200,000 in capital gains tax because he didn't get a step up in capital gains basis. So a lot of the planning you do with clients in the estate planning world has to do with capital gains more so than taxes, because now there's $11.2 million exemption. Direct transfers, most people have retirement accounts, life insurance, annuities, with beneficiary designations attached to them. Make sure those things are filled out correctly and they name the right people, okay? And there are all kinds of, in the retirement account world, all kinds of stretch out opportunities to defer income tax out. That's another 2-hour seminar. But just make sure they're filled out correctly. Joint tenancy with right of survivorship, it's an okay way to do your estate plan, all right? However, it doesn't matter what your will says, it doesn't matter what your trust says. If somebody's on the property as a joint tenant or on the account as a joint tenant, they get it despite what all your documents say, okay? So make sure, you know, and what's one of the big problems with joint tenancy? The people that like being married get married again. So in other words, what a lot of elderly clients do that don't have estate planning attorneys in their life is they lose their spouse, they get lonely, they meet somebody new, doesn't want to live in the house where they live with their old spouse. So they buy a new spouse. They buy a new spouse. That was Freudian. So I'll have to use that next time. So they buy a house with a new spouse, and how do they take it? Joint tenancy with right of survivorship. And then guess who gets the estate? The kids of the surviving joint tenant and not the kids of the first joint tenant who died. Okay, and there are solutions to that. Okay. All right. Transfer on death deeds. This is kind of a new thing. You can have a deed now that has a beneficiary designation associated with it. So right on the deed, you can have a beneficiary designation. I was the lead opponent of that about 4 years ago in front of the Senate Judiciary Committee and got it defeated. Why did I not like that? Because I would say once every month, it happens once every month. I'm not saying it's a daughter or a son. I'll use an example of a son this time. Okay, so a son brings his mother in. All right, she's 95. The son's lived with the mother for a year, okay? They own a house in Redwood City worth $1.5 million, and they have 4 other kids. And so the son does all the talking. You know, I've been taking care of mom, the other kids are a bunch of deadbeats. They don't do anything. And my mom has decided that I should get the house when she dies. And so the mom just looking at the son, says, is this what you wanna do? Whatever he wants to do, you know, like that kind of thing, whatever he wants. And so basically the pay on death deed, the problem with the pay on death deed, he can just go down to Staples and pick one up and have her sign it. You know, it's like the litigation attorney's employment act, you know what I mean? So the old law was that, you know, she would have to go through me. I would get a doctor's note. I'd get a real extensive doctor's declaration. I'd probably get an evaluation. I'd make sure that's what she really wanted to do. I would kick him out of the room, okay? And then I'd meet with her and make sure that's what she wanted to do. And even then, I'm not sure I'd do it, okay? So now with this new system here with transfer on death deeds, the lawyer doesn't have to be involved. deeds because it's a simple deed. But it does avoid probate in the situation where people do have capacity and wanna leave their estate a certain way without probate. And it avoids estate claims. How am I doing on time? 5 minutes, okay. Okay, wills are okay documents, okay, but they're just death documents. That's all they are. They don't do anything for you during life, and they cause probate, okay? And they cause guardianships usually, all right? So probates are usually the fee for a probate to transfer assets is between 3 and 6% of the value of the estate. It's not the fee so much, it's pretty much the, I find in my probates that usually it's a probate of a single person and a kid is serving as an executor and they usually waive their fee. Why? Because the other kids would hate them if they didn't waive a fee. But most of it's because income tax reasons. The lawyer usually doesn't waive the fee. Okay, so trusts are just imagine a trust is like a bucket and you stick assets in the bucket. Once they're in the bucket and you own them as a trustee, that's another word for a manager. Once they're in the bucket, you set up incapacity planning and you've avoided probate, okay? And then you've knocked out all those other things we've talked about as long as you do your durable powers of attorney and you do your advanced healthcare directives along with a trust, okay? All right, now, I wrote a little note down there. Probate avoidance blocks Medi-Cal claims for reimbursement. So now trusts are very, very important because the state can still, if you're on Medi-Cal, can still come after your property if it passes through a formal probate. So if you have it on a pay on death deed, you have it in joint tenancy, you have a beneficiary designation connected to an account, anything that avoids probate then avoids an estate claim. So they can only make an estate claim for reimbursement against you in probate court. So make sure the estate plan is set up properly in order to avoid that. All right, I'm gonna make you an expert in how taxes work in 2 minutes. Okay. All right. So death tax. The Republicans call it the death tax. The Democrats call it the estate tax. All right. It's interesting how the blue senators are for the death the estate tax, but the red senators are against it. And the blue states pay all the death tax, and the red states pay no death tax. Okay. Well, how do you get that? Right. But that's the politics of it. I think there were 4 death tax returns in Maine last year, okay? So basically when you die, I used to say if you die, I always have hope, but when you die, okay, basically they get your gross estate, they look at your gross estate. What's your gross estate? Everything you own, your house, your life insurance, your car, whatever it is, all that is your gross estate and they tax it 40%. Okay, but there's exemptions. One big one is if you're married and you leave everything to your spouse, there's no death tax, okay? Second, you have this exemption if you leave your estate to someone other than your spouse, you now have an $11.2 million exemption. That's why the death tax affects 1 in 1,000 people in the United States. So now it's not part of the long-term care plan. I used to have gift tax issues because let's just talk about gift tax for a second. Okay, you can give your entire death exemption of $11.2 million during your life. Plus $15,000 a year. So I can give $15,000 to everybody I like today, and I still can leave $11.2 million when I die. However, say my kid's getting married, say my eldest son's getting married, he says, Dad, can I have $115,000? Oh, sure, Kellen, here it is. I give him $115,000. What have I done? I just gave him an excess gift of $100,000 over that $15,000. What happens now? I can only leave $11,100 when I die. So I can give Kellen that whole $11,200 this year if I wanted to. So now in the long-term care, I used to have $1 million cap where I would create a gift tax. If I was to gift houses above $1 million, I'd have problems. Now I don't have any of those problems, but now I don't need to gift the house anymore because I don't have any estate claims to worry about. Okay, so there's a test after this. I want you to know that. But anyway, so the other thing between spouses, imagine this exemption's like a little coupon in your pocket. Okay, worth 11.2. When you die, if you left everything to your spouse, they can file a death tax return for you and pick up your coupon. They can port your $11.2 million exemption over to them. Now they've got $22.4 million to use with the kids. Isn't that incredible? Okay, it's terrible. But anyway, I already talked about the kind of giving you a clue there. I already talked about capital gains tax, how it works, step up in basis. So I always say the only good thing about dying in our country, you get a step up in basis when you die. So make sure you plan your estate correctly so you don't make any gifts that cause capital gains tax. Last tax, property tax, the big hurt. Okay, so when you're dealing with seniors with houses, make sure that whoever gets the property at death or during life, if you make lifetime gifts of real property, is the right person. So you don't cause a Prop 13 reappraisal. So I love these clients in Palo Alto, they're paying $1,500 a year in property tax, and they're living in I'm not jealous of them, believe me, but I'm just saying they're living, they've been living in a $5 million house. If that got reappraised under Prop 13, the tax becomes $60,000 a year as opposed to $1,500 a year, but they can leave the property to their kids through a parent-child transfer if it's done correctly. They can also leave another $1 million worth of assessed value property, not market value, assessed without a Prop 13 reappraisal. So you just have to make sure you don't cause what's called a change of ownership for property tax when you do your estate planning. So now you are an expert in estate planning, taxes, and long-term care. All right, thank you.